In this video, we're going to be talking about what your contractor needs to know about attaching plywood to the bolted mud sill. There's only one tested method. It's called the flush cut method, and it's the one that your contractor should be using. There are three other methods, which we're also going to discuss, which your contractor may want to use, but you should be aware of all of these so that when you buy your retrofit, again, you're getting what you paid for and you're getting something that you know will work.
Here we will discuss the different ways of attaching plywood to the mud sill. Normally the mud sills are wider than the 2x4 uprights on the cripple wall. This means that if you were simply to nail the plywood to the cripple wall, the plywood would not be attached to the mud sill. As you can see by the photograph on the right, the plywood is sitting on top of the mud sill rather than being attached to the mud sill where the bolts are. This means as the earthquake force causes the bottom of the plywood to slide back and forth, it would slide on top of the mud sill and not be restrained by the bolts. One way of achieving this is by nailing 2x4 blocks to the bolted mud sill in between the 2x4 upright studs of the cripple wall. Then the piece of plywood is nailed to the blocks and to the 2x4 studs and the top plate of the cripple wall. Then, when the earthquake force tries to push the piece of plywood on top of the mud sill, that earthquake force is transferred into the blocks, then into the bolts, and into the foundation. Here's a photograph of someone installing cripple wall blocking. This is normally done with a nail gun. As you can see, the mud sill is much wider than the upright 2x4 studs. Now, in between the studs, the carpenter is installing the 2x4 blocks so that the plywood can be nailed to the blocks. One of the problems with nailed blocks is that the blocks can split. This happens because for a retrofit to be effective from an engineering point of view, large nails are required. Oftentimes, carpenters substitute these larger nails with smaller nails because the nails do not split the blocks. However, from an engineering point of view, nailed blocks that are nailed with small nails will not be effective. As you can see, there is plywood nailed to the block from the other side onto the face of the 2x4. Nailing of the plywood can also cause this surface to split. Here's another case of a split block. As you can see, the carpenter needed to notch the block in order to fit around the bolt. This further shortened the block and created higher potential for it to split. This method is identical to the nailed blocking method, except staples are used. Staples are used because they will not split the blocks. It is important then when attaching the plywood to these blocks that staples are used through the plywood. Otherwise, if nails are used, the blocks will split. Stapled shear walls are fully approved by the American Plywood Association and the International Building Code. This photograph shows why staples should be used whenever blocks are necessary. The block to mud sill connection here has the same capacity as 40 nails. Another method of attaching the plywood to the mud sill is called the reverse block method. As you can see by illustration number one, the two components are piece of plywood and a 2x4. Illustration number two shows how the plywood and the 2x4 are connected. You can't see the nails on the back, but the plywood has been nailed to the 2x4. Then this entire assembly is placed on top of the mud sill, and that it's nailed into the mud sill downward and then also into the cripple wall itself. Here is a photograph of a carpenter using the reverse blocking method. He is using his nail gun to nail the reverse block into the mud sill. Once he's done here, he will nail the plywood to the cripple wall. The last method we will discuss is the flush cut method. In this method, the mud sill is cut flush with the 2x4 studs so that now the mud sill is also a 2x4. Once this is done, the plywood is nailed directly into the mud sill and into the upright studs and into the top plate. In shear wall tests were always done with 2x4s on the bottom, 2x4s on the tops, and 2x4s on the sides. This is actually the only method that's ever been tested, with thousands of tests done by the American Plywood Association. This special saw is being used to cut the mud sill flush with the 2x4 studs. Here is a photograph of a mud sill that's been cut flush with the 2x4 studs. Now the plywood will be nailed onto the mud sill and onto the 2x4 uprights, plus up at the top plate where the floor is. It needs to be emphasized that this is the only tested method based on thousands of tests done by the American Plywood Association. In these tests, the shear walls were made of 2x4s. 2x4s on the bottom, 2x4s on the sides, and 2x4s on the top. Besides the flush cut method, none of them have been tested before, and I doubt you want your house to be the experiment to see if they actually work. The piece of wood on the left is a flush cut redwood mud sill. The piece of wood on the right is from a tree farm. Notice the very, very tight growth rings in the redwood mud sill, which is perhaps 2,000 years old. The reason you want to use the flush cut method is because you want your shear wall made of such high quality wood.
If you look on the website, we have a section called Contractor Screening. And on the Contractor Screening page, you'll see different questions that you should ask your contractor before you hire them. It's important for you to understand what the answers to those questions are so you can speak intelligently to your contractor about how to retrofit your home. Now, I've seen many, many houses that were retrofitted where people spent between $10,000 and $15,000, sometimes more, on retrofits that simply will not work. And that's because the contractor did not understand what he was doing. Even though they may have done lots and lots of work, and even though there might have been lots of shiny hardware, it still was not going to be effective. So that's why it's so important for you as a homeowner to protect your own home and to realize in general, as far as earthquake preparedness goes, the government is not going to help you. You have to help yourself.